Hello, everyone. If you could please find your seats, we're going to begin the program. Please welcome to the stage Felicia Wasson, Director of Stakeholder Relations at the Coca-Cola Company, who is sponsoring the Representation Matters Luncheon for brief remarks.
Good afternoon. Give me some Matt. Good afternoon. Aren't you happy to be here?
Yes.
What a beautiful room. Good afternoon. I am Felicia Wasson, and I have the privilege of serving as the Director of Stakeholder Relations for Coca-Cola North America Group. On behalf of my colleagues here today, we welcome you to the International LGBT Leaders Plenary Luncheon. We are pleased you have joined us at this valuable conference, which highlights the gains, the growth, and opportunities that are occurring around the nation. For the third consecutive year, Coca-Cola is proud to work with Victory Fund and Institute. It is our mission to refresh the world, inspire moments of optimism and happiness, create value, and to make a difference. To that end, the Coca-Cola Company has an ongoing commitment to promoting diversity and inclusion. We truly believe that the beauty of the world lies in the diversity of its people. Just this week, we were honored to have received a 100% rating from the Human Rights Campaign based on an in-depth analysis. You can give that an applause. And that was based on an in-depth analysis of our workplace policies and practices for LGBT associates. It is because of our dedication to LGBT advancement and equality that we consider it a privilege to know, work, and partner with the Victory Fund. Our company clearly recognizes that our pathway to the future includes each of us to encourage equality, fight injustice, and develop representation from the LGBT community. We are extremely proud of our Next Generation LGBT Leaders Initiative, which provides leadership training for LGBT leaders 30 years of age and under. 34 of our Next Generation Initiative fellows have joined us here at the conference, and I'd like to ask them to please stand and be recognized. At Coca-Cola, the idea of bringing people together for good is one of our inherent philosophies. We truly believe that coming together and working together, combining our resources and leveraging all of our strengths, is the best way to develop solutions to address issues. To that end, it is our hope that you educate, engage, and enjoy yourself while attending the conference. We know our world will surely be better for it. On behalf of the more than 79,000 Coca-Cola North America System Associates, thank you for the opportunity to join you here today.
Please welcome to the stage the mayor of Santa Fe, New Mexico, Javier Gonzales.
Good afternoon, everybody. You guys enjoying a good time here in Washington and having a good time interacting with one another. It's a little quiet, Aisha. You guys enjoying yourselves?
Yes.
All right. My name is Javier Gonzales. I have the incredible pleasure of being mayor of the city of Santa Fe, and I am so thankful for the privilege to be able to announce our next speaker, Victory Institute's fearless leader, Aisha Moodie-Mills. Aisha is among the smartest and the most committed activists in our movement today. And she has a bold and broad vision for LGBT equality. As president and CEO of the Victory Institute, Aisha leads a passionate team committed to developing a diverse pipeline of LGBT leaders who will lead the fight for equality across the country. She understands the power of representation and is leading the charge in uniting and expanding LGBT leadership nationwide. And let me share something with you. Before Election Day, most of us thought Hillary Clinton would be our next president. And this conference was largely focused on making a Clinton administration the most LGBT inclusive in history. And then reality struck, and Donald Trump was elected president. While most of us were still wallowing in our sorrow, Aisha saw through a fog and realized that this International LGBT Leaders Conference must pivot, that it had the potential to unify and better our movement for equality in perilous times. Her vision, her foresight, is why yesterday we held the largest closed-door strategy session of LGBT elected officials in history. It is why this conference is now about using the collective power of LGBT elected officials and leaders to protect our rights and fight back against hateful efforts of the next administration. Her vision is why Victory Institute is positioned to be one of the most important players in our movement for equality in the coming months and years. Now, I love the Victory Institute, and I'm also proud to be a 2016 Victory Institute Bonet Leaders Fellow. Through the fellowship, I had the privilege of attending a three-week intensive executive training program at the Harvard Kennedy School of Government, where we honed our leadership skills and learned how to be more effective leaders for our communities. This program, like other Victory Institute programs, is helping elected officials be the fighters that we need to fight in the coming years. And I know well that LGBT leaders and LGBT representation, that it matters. And to quote Aisha herself, when we're not at the table, we're on the menu. And I need to say, coming from New Mexico, I've seen firsthand how important it is to be at the table. As a mayor, I've worked hard to create an inclusive city that is for everybody, where full participation matters. And one of my first acts as mayor was to propose a gender-neutral bathroom ordinance, which I'm proud went into effect very quickly. I also had the opportunity to condemn the Republican legislature whenever they would promote legislative items that promoted hate. And most recently, had the opportunity to talk about the values of Santa Fe in defending our community as being a sanctuary city and standing up to the Trump efforts to try and penalize Trump cities as being places that are welcoming people from all over. Now, as Trump stacks his administration, with anti-LGBT activists, some who even endorse conversion therapy, Aisha and Victory's Institute's work will become more important than any time in recent history. We need more people like Senator Tammy Baldwin. We need more people like Representative Sean Patrick Maloney. And we need to support Aisha while she's in office, leading us in positions of power. We as a movement need a cohesive plan of attack, and I'm heartened by the possibilities of what we can accomplish during the rest of this conference. So, Aisha, thank you for your leadership. My brothers and sisters, please give it up for our incredible leader, Ms. Aisha Moodie-Mills.
Hey, good afternoon. Oh my goodness, y'all can do better than that. Good afternoon. There are clearly not a lot of people from the black church in here. It's called call and response. Thank you so much, Mayor Gonzales, for that fabulous introduction. And more importantly, thank you for all of your leadership and your efforts down in Santa Fe. So, friends, it's been exactly 1 month since the election, and I know it feels like a lifetime ago. Before the results came in, like the mayor said, I was expecting to come to this conference and introduce you to dozens of new LGBT leaders who'd swept into office with an historic wind at their backs. And I was planning to launch the next phase of our presidential appointments program. This time, poised to build upon our work that led President Obama to appoint more LGBT people to positions in federal government than all other administrations combined. What's that? How's that for a legacy? And we were going to launch our campaign for our first LGBT cabinet secretary here today. Well, we didn't quite get the results we'd hoped for on Election Day. And instead, on November 8th, racism, homophobia, xenophobia, and sexism ultimately won the day. And to all our dismay, the Trump administration continues to double down on the divisive demagoguery of his campaign by appointing anti-equality advisors and cabinet members to serve in the White House. Leaders who are toxic for our community and our nation generally, and who have vowed to roll back the gains we have made over the past 8 years. So many in our community are afraid of what this new administration means for them. We see the rise in bigotry and hate and feel caught in its crosshairs. We fear that we're going to hear more stories like this one from Colorado, where a transgender woman named Amber had moved into a new neighborhood in Denver, thinking that it would be welcoming to her and a place to call home. 1 week after the election, she woke up, got ready for work, and stepped outside like any other day. But then she saw her car. Someone had taken black spray paint and covered it in death threats, transphobic slurs, and a swastika. Amber told the local news, quote, "Because of the Trump thing, it's all coming back. It's coming back hard." Now, Donald Trump can say he's pro-LGBT all he wants. Well, that is, if he can actually manage to put the letters together correctly. But as we speak, he is stoking hate and stocking his cabinet and senior staff with our community's most extreme opponents. Folks, it is coming back, and it's coming back hard. And make no mistake about it, this is not business as usual. The rhetoric and bad actors taking over our federal government are not the new normal. And we cannot sit idly by and placate them and let them win. I know that many of us still feel the hurt and disappointment and sting of election night. But I'm here to tell you that all hope is not lost. In fact, as I look around this room, I am reminded that our future ultimately looks mighty bright. This room, the largest gathering of LGBT elected and appointed officials ever, represents the inspiration, the resolve, and the grit to overcome the challenges that lie ahead. You see, LGBT leaders are the antidote to this extremism. You are the army of influence that we rely on to combat hate and to drive policies that safeguard all of our communities. You are the tour de force beating back disgraceful anti-LGBT bills and efforts to thwart voting rights and women's rights in state legislatures. You are the ones creating cities and communities that are welcoming to our transgender neighbors and our immigrant friends. You are the ones who have lived through gut-wrenching prejudice here and around the globe and have forged a way so that we can all see a brighter day. The power in this room is palpable. You feel that energy? Just being in this space with you, our LGBT leaders, gives us hope. And so I pledge to you today that Victory Institute will be a more robust resource for you. We'll facilitate a stronger network where you can connect with your colleagues and draw strength through community. We'll share best practices and keep you abreast of LGBT movement strategy and policy ideas to aid you in your work. And we will lift you up as the moral leaders that you are and amplify the amazing work that you're doing to drive the country forward and the world forward. Because you are the leaders that we have all been waiting for. And you will be the change that we so desperately need in this moment. Yesterday, during our elected official strategy session, I was reminded that our community is strongest when our backs are against the wall and when the wind is in our face. Folks, we survived the horror of the 1980s.
Act up.
Even as our government failed to act, as so many of our friends perished around us. And we've come full circle from the 90s, when the federal government relegated us to second-class citizens through Don't Ask, Don't Tell and the Defense of Marriage Act. And we've prevailed since the 2004 slaughter at the polls, where voters in 11 states amended their constitutions to ban marriage equality. We've seen dark days, but in the end, we always thrive. And it's largely because of the passion and the courage and the drive of our LGBT elected and appointed officials. Some of you might remember when Victory brought a delegation of LGBT electeds from around the country to the White House. They met with President Clinton to demand that his administration engage the LGBT community and beef up funding to address the HIV/AIDS crisis. And he did. And many of you in this room rallied to get Roberta Actenberg appointed as Assistant Secretary at HUD, which made her the first LGBT person to be confirmed by the US Senate for a federal position. Time and time again, you prove that when LGBT leaders flex their power, they open doors and break through lavender ceilings. There were only a few dozen out elected officials back then, but today there are well over 500. Just think how powerful your voices would ring out if you band together to advance a common agenda. Now is the time to flex your collective power. Because together, you are an army of influence. You are a resilient caucus of resistance that won't be denied. Now, will we win every battle? Will it happen overnight? Will it be easy? Of course not. But we have been here before and we have prevailed. Our opponents may have won an election, but we are winning the electorate. Let us not forget that the majority of Americans share our values, and they are on our side. We continue to win hearts and minds. So now it's time for us to lick our wounds, because we can't let up. We have to stay fired up. You with me? Can't hear you. You with me? Good, because our time has come. And to fully seize it, we must support our LGBT leaders all across this country and the world as they work to create an inclusive and just society for all of us. We must also encourage more LGBT people to run for office up and down the ballot, because we are still widely underrepresented across this country. And many of you in this room are the first or the only LGBT person to serve in your state. And by the way, the battle for LGBT rights will ultimately be fought and won at the state level. Just this year, we were up against more than 200 anti-LGBT bills across the country, measures that aim to denigrate and discriminate against us for simply daring to live, love, and labor out loud. And this was the backdrop of an administration that understands that we are Americans worthy of the same rights and responsibilities that our neighbors enjoy. Luckily, we beat many of those back, but our losses came in the states where we had few, if any, LGBT elected officials. States like North Carolina, where HB2 was passed when there were no LGBT people serving in the state legislature to debate it. But North Carolina has also risen up as a beacon of hope. Voters in the state, the vast majority of which elected Donald Trump, simultaneously ousted the governor who championed the bill and signed discrimination into law. Yep. They sent a message loud and clear that bigotry is not a winning strategy. So friends, the wind is in our face, but we are powerful, and our army of influence is growing. In November, Oregon's Kate Brown became the first openly LGBT person elected governor in this country. Yes. Carlos Guillermo Smith became the first openly LGBT Latino elected to the Florida State Legislature, representing Orlando and many of the Latinx people who danced at Pulse nightclub that horrific night. And Daniel Hernandez, a gun violence survivor, also known for saving the life of Congresswoman Gabby Giffords, was elected to the Arizona State Legislature. And Georgia expanded LGBT representation in its state house, electing Sam Park to join three other openly LGBT voices. And when people spray painted Amber's car in Denver, State Representative Leslie Harrod was there. Just days before, Leslie had been elected the first Black LGBT state legislator in Colorado. And she immediately responded by holding a civil rights for all forum that saw historic turnout of community members from all walks of life. Because of elected officials like Leslie and all of you gathered here, transphobia and this type of despicable hate will not have the last word. Bigotry and discrimination will not have the last word in Denver or anywhere else across this country. And the persecution that we face around the world will not have the last word because of the courageous LGBT officials serving all across the globe. You know who will have the last word? You will. And how you use your voice today matters, guys. It matters. Because we are in for quite a ride with this new administration. But I have faith, as Dr. King did, that the arc of the moral universe, while long, always bends towards justice. If you believe that justice is just over the horizon, then let's join arms with our allies and work together more collaboratively than we ever have before. And if you believe that democracy matters, we need you to run for office and give your community the representation that it deserves. And if you know, like I do, that our time is now, then let's meet on the front lines today to fight for equality and justice for all, because we cannot just wait and see. Our lives depend on it. So let's roll up our sleeves and get to work, y'all. Onward to victory. Thank you.
Please welcome to the stage Physician General for the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and Professor of Pediatrics and Psychiatry at the Penn State College of Medicine, Dr. Rachel Levine.
Good afternoon. I'm so pleased to be here. I'd like to thank Aisha and the Victory Institute and all of the staff for inviting me. It's an honor to be speaking with United States Senator Tammy Baldwin and United States Representative Sean Patrick Maloney, and Mayor Gonzales. So thank you very much. So I thought that I would talk a little bit in terms of defining a seat at the table, a little bit about my story to illustrate the principles. So for many years, I have been a physician at the Penn State Hershey Medical Center and a professor at the Penn State College of Medicine. My field has been adolescent medicine, the medical care of teenagers. I think that what we've learned, certainly over the last month, is that everything comes down to adolescent medicine. So I was at Penn State Hershey Medical Center, and I transitioned approximately 6 years ago. And you know, Penn State Hershey in Hershey, Pennsylvania, is not Philadelphia. Okay, so it is in the heartland of Pennsylvania. In fact, Donald Trump, I believe, is going there as part of his victory tour. So I'm in Hershey, Pennsylvania, and I am transitioning as an openly transgender woman. Expecting that I might have a difficult time. But you know, Pennsylvania and Penn State and the medical center surprise us. Don't make any assumptions about things. So I was very, very pleased that Penn State Hershey advanced their non-discrimination policy. Previously, their non-discrimination policy included sexual orientation. They amended it to include gender identity and expression. That is now called the Levine policy. And thank you. And really, with the work of the diversity office, they created an environment that was not just tolerant. You know, a tolerant environment. Thank you very much for tolerating me. I appreciate that very much. It wasn't just accepting, but it really was welcoming and celebratory of diversity in all of its aspects, including for LGBT individuals. So I'm doing my job in academic medicine and seeing my patients and teaching my students. And then I got a phone call from the Wolf administration just about 2 years ago, asking if I would be the co-chair of the Transitions Committee for Health for Governor-elect Wolf. And I was trying to think of why I got that phone call, and I think really the main reason is because I specialized in transitions. So I accepted that, said I'm not giving up my day job, you know, I've been in academic medicine all my life, and so, but I'd be pleased to do that, and worked with the other co-chair, Dr. Karen Hacker in Allegheny County, and a committee to draft the transitions document. And so we met with the outgoing team, we met with our committee, et cetera. And then in January of 2015, as we were finishing up that document, I started to have some discussions about this position, that I would actually leave the medical center and take this position. In the course of about 10 days, I met the Transitions Committee head, I met the Chief of Staff, I met Governor Wolf. The Thursday before the inauguration, I got a phone call saying, Governor Wolf will call you tomorrow. Got a phone call the next day from Governor Wolf offering me this position. I accepted. The next day it was announced. On Monday, I saw patients till 6 o'clock. On Tuesday was the inauguration and the swearing in, and on Wednesday I walk into the Department of Health in Pennsylvania. So it was quite a ride. And then everyone figured out that actually I had to be confirmed by the overwhelmingly conservative State Senate of Pennsylvania. That posed an interesting challenge. So it was really a very exciting experience and very educational. It was very educational to me about the legislative process. And you know what? Having an openly transgender woman walk into their office, shake their hand, and talk about public health was very educational for them as well. And one of the things I'm most proud of is that I was unanimously confirmed by the State Senate in June of 2015. The press has been rather interesting in this regard. I went to the fantastic symposium you had yesterday with the ambassadors. And at some times, in regards to the press, I felt like the ambassador to Pennsylvania, the first openly transgender woman ambassador in Pennsylvania. Because all of the press at the beginning talked about the transgender physician general, Dr. Rachel Levine. I kept waiting to meet the cisgender physician general of Pennsylvania. Never met her. I don't understand. But one of the one thing that was very meaningful, I did a press conference. One of the topics that I go out and speak about a lot is opioids. Really, biggest health crisis that we have in Pennsylvania, and you could argue the nation in terms of overdoses, and it's one of my signature issues. And so I'm speaking about that, and the press was covering that in Philadelphia. And I got a phone call from one of my friends saying, the press just did a story about that press conference, and it didn't mention the word transgender. And so really, unless I'm bringing it up in terms of speaking about LGBT issues now, when I go out throughout Pennsylvania talking about public health issues, talking about opioids, talking about Zika virus, talking about influenza, they don't mention the fact transgender anymore. It is just Physician General Rachel Levine. And I think that that's a victory. It has been so important to have a seat at the table, to be an LGBT individual with a seat at the table, to be a member of Governor Wolf's cabinet. Governor Wolf is absolutely fantastic. He is a fantastic leader, and he is a strong ally and supporter for our community. So under his leadership, what we've been able to do is to form an LGBT work group. And I am very proud to chair that work group under the auspices of the Governor's Policy Office. And we have brought in all of the departments, all of the agencies, and we have a monthly work group to talk about LGBT issues. At that work group, we have been able to change birth certificate policy in Pennsylvania so that individuals do not need to have some type of operation to change the gender on their birth certificate. We have been able to change birth certificates so in January, they will say parent and parent as opposed to mother and father. Pennsylvania Medicaid, thank you. Medicaid in Pennsylvania now covers gender confirmation treatment for transgender individuals in all of its forms. It covers psychological evaluation and treatment, medical evaluation and treatment, and surgical evaluation and treatment. We have been able to work with the Department of Education for safety for LGBT individuals and to try to implement the Title IX regulations from the Obama administration about transgender individuals in schools. We have worked very hard with the Department of Corrections for LGBT individuals and particularly for transgender individuals in corrections. We have actually formed a virtual support group in corrections with approximately 50 transgender individuals from 10 different correctional institutions who have a monthly virtual support group through technology with all of their faces on the screen, like it would be here, and they all can talk to each other where they can really talk to someone who feels the same way for the first time. And the next program we're going to start is actually an LGBT support group for staff in the administration. So although it's tempting to get discouraged and cynical in these days, we can't. We simply cannot. This is a call to action. We have to keep working, and we have to keep fighting. We have to offer a strong defense in the states to mitigate impact from potential impact from the federal government and our community. We have to have a strong and resilient community. And as I mentioned yesterday in one of the groups, we have to be united and stick together. Because if we do not, our opponents will pick us apart. Fairness, justice, inequality are on our side. History is on our side. And to quote from the most fantastic musical ever, no matter what someone says or tweets, to quote from Hamilton, we do not want to throw away our shot. Because history has its eyes on us. Thank you very much.
Please welcome Congressman Sean Patrick Maloney, representative for New York's 18th Congressional District.
Hello, good afternoon. All right, come on, let's wake up. We had lunch. Good afternoon. How are we all doing? Anything happened last month? Because I've been a little busy. All right, look, I am Sean Patrick Maloney. I am the first openly gay person ever elected to Congress from the state of New York. Are there New Yorkers here? I see some down here. Come on, where's New York? I see Corey Johnson, Rosie Mendez. Thank you, guys. Eric Botcher, thank you, guys, for being here. My partners in crime from New York. Listen, I have to tell you, I get to say something that no congressman from New York has ever been able to say before, which is my husband is here, right there, Randy Florkey. And, you know, Randy and I have been together for 24 years. We've been married for two. Not sure it's working out, but I told him I'd give him a quarter century, three kids, and we'd see. But we have three children together, and, you know, some of you may have seen my speech at the convention where I talked about a bunch of stuff, and the only thing anybody remembered was that in the middle of my speech, I said, I love you, honey, in an off-cuff, you know, just off-the-cuff way to Randy. And I thought that was remarkable, that sometimes the biggest impact we make, right, is just by not being embarrassed about who we are. And when you love your partner, saying, I love you, honey. So, I love you, honey. There you go. So, yeah, see, be good. Be good. And it's a thrill. Those of you who know Randy know what I'm talking about. It is a thrill for me to be here with my hero and my sister, Senator Tammy Baldwin from the great state of Wisconsin. Love her. And I know you're going to hear from her in a minute. And I'm so impressed by Dr. Levine. That's fantastic. And the fact that you got confirmed unanimously is remarkable. That is really a testament to you. And I look forward to hearing more about all your good work in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And to Mayor Gonzales, thank you so much for your words as well. You know, my husband, Randy, has been very active in something called the Bard Prison Initiative, which is a terrific program at Bard College in the Hudson Valley to provide an opportunity for inmates in federal and state prison to gain an undergraduate degree from Bard College. And it is the same undergraduate degree conferred on the undergraduates who go to the college on campus. And the classes are actually taught by Bard faculty in prison. And Randy has become so enthralled with this program that he had me speak at the graduation at Woodburn Correctional Facility not long ago. And he's been a leader in raising funds and proselytizing about the need for prison education programs, which is, first of all, awesome. So thank you for doing that work. But the reason I raise it today is because, yeah, give me a hand. You're doing well here. You're doing well. This is all about you. You can tell I must be in trouble for something. I'm just falling all over my husband. No, this is every day in our house, every day. And so the reason I bring this up is because, you know, Randy said to me recently that I'm going to give a lecture in prison to one of these classes, but, you know, I'm going to do it. And I don't mean me, I mean him. And I said, that's great. What are you going to do it on? He said, I'm going to do it on the history of the LGBT movement. And I said, well, great, where are you going to do it? And he said, I'm doing it in a maximum security prison. I said, that's great. How do you think that's going to go? And he said, I don't know, I think it'll go great. And so two nights ago, Randy gave a lecture on the history of the LGBT movement to a sold-out kind of capacity group of inmates at the maximum security facility, where was it? In Eastern Correctional Facility in New York. And I was so impressed by that. And it warmed my heart to know that there was that level of interest even among people who are in obviously a very difficult context. And the thing he said, and that I've been thinking about, is he said it made him remember everything that's happened to us just in our lifetimes as LGBT people. And it made him go back and relive what it was like in the 80s when our friends were dying, literally dying, and their government was, you know, looking the other way at best, or mocking us. Ridiculing us. And we had to build our own organizations and build our institutions and take care of one another and overcome this horrific challenge of the HIV and AIDS epidemic. And so he came home and you know, if you're like us, you've been in your Trump five stages of grief. Who's in their five stages of grief? You know what I'm talking about? Right, where you're mad and then you're depressed and then you're yelling at the neighbor and then you're, you know, you're just like bargaining and then you're, yeah, no, I know. It's terrible, right? And he said, can't tell you something? Those were dark days, when we were literally dying because the government was ignoring us. Those were dark days. He said, these may be dark days, but they're nothing like that. We are equal to this challenge. I am here to declare an official end to Trump mourning. It's been a month. We're all going to get over it right now. So if you take off the black armband and stop, like, you know, talking to your mom about what went wrong just right now, we've got work to do. I think a month is long enough to mope around. I am guilty of it as much as anybody. And I just want to tell you, number one, I think it's time to wake up and get to work. And I will say that we have not come this far to give up now, right? I mean, come on. I mean, think about what we have achieved. I mean, there are people, right? Come on. There are people in America who can be cynical and depressed about what's going on in our politics. God knows. And there are people who are scared to death, and they have every right to be, because this guy has said he will do terrible things, and we should take that seriously. But I want to tell you that we, as a people in the LGBTQ community, we are kicking ass from Washington to Florida and from Maine to California. We are winning in the legislatures. We're electing candidates. We're holding our own. We are not going backwards. We're going forwards. And Donald Trump is not bigger than that. He is not bigger than our movement. He's not bigger than our love. He's not bigger than the Constitution of the United States. He's not bigger than our friends and our allies and our corporate partners, all of whom have joined us in recent years on this journey. And we have written our rights into American jurisprudence and into the referenda that we are winning everywhere. And so while this has been a bad year, we as a people are still moving forward. And we need to remember who we are. We need to remember who we've lost. And we need to keep faith with that level of commitment and sacrifice and grit and determination and pull ourselves up and move forward. And I think if you look around the country this year, there is every reason to feel good about that part of what's happening in America. I mean, check it out. The number one issue in the North Carolina governor's race was HB2. And who's governor of North Carolina now? It's not the guy who signed it, right? And in case you think that wasn't that big an issue, Donald Trump won the state by 63,000 votes. Richard Burr, the Republican, won the state by 93,000 votes. And Pat McGrory, running on a platform of anti-LGBT bigotry, lost the state by 10,000 votes. The voters of North Carolina rejected hate directed towards our community when they were electing Donald Trump. That says something powerful about the resilience of our movement, and we should feel good about that. And I think if you look at Scott Garrett's race in New Jersey, anybody here from New Jersey? You know how awful Scott Garrett was. This was a conservative Republican from northern New Jersey who said the Republican Party was too favorable to gay people. Just hold that thought for a minute. I know we're a bipartisan group here somewhere, but he said the trying to be good. And actually wouldn't pay his dues because he said they were going to have, they were going to maybe support some gay Republican candidates. And he wouldn't pay his dues. And he said a bunch of other stupid things about LGBT people. And what Josh Gottheimer, a great and energetic young challenger, said was that we shouldn't have a bigot as a representative from the state of New Jersey. And he got between him and the financial services community, even though the guy's on the committee. He raised a ton of money, and he made that the single defining aspect of Scott Garrett's reelection campaign was that he was anti-gay. And guess what? He knocked him out in a year when Trump was winning that district. So if you can point me to an example where being pro-LGBT equality cost somebody a race or set us back, I'd love to know it. I mean, there may be people who fell short who didn't win. I know a lot of you run races. I know a lot of you have experience in it. I'm not here to say this is the most popular thing in every part of the country. But I think what is fascinating is that the more we live as who we are, the more we speak from the heart, the more we sound like real people and not consultants, the fact is that we can win these races. We can win these battles. And that brings me to a little something I like to call the Maloney Amendment. Have you heard about this? You know what I'm talking about? So you want to clap for that? It'd be awesome. But no, I don't. I'm good. Believe me, you're going to be clapping by the time I'm done. So you may have just heard this week we had a big victory on the defense bill. But it started back in May when a guy named Steve Russell from Oklahoma snuck an anti-gay amendment into the defense bill for the United States of America, and it was called the Russell Amendment. And what the Russell Amendment was going to do is it was going to roll back two executive orders that Barack Obama had issued that simply extended to our community the same non-discrimination provisions that apply to others. So it extended anti-discrimination policies that theretofore had been about race or gender or religion or national origin or disability to LGBTQ people. That's it. So you can't be fired if you work for a government contractor if you're LGBT. And there are 28 million Americans who work right now at organizations that fit within that definition. So this is a big deal. And the fact is that companies like ExxonMobil and others who get federal dollars, and we're talking about taxpayer dollars. If you get taxpayer dollars, you shouldn't be firing people because of who they love, because of their sexual orientation or gender identity or expression. That's it. But this was too much for these guys 2 years after the president had put them in place. So Russell sneaks this amendment into the bill, and a bunch of us object to it. And on the House floor, you know, I said this is anti-gay bias being written into federal law, and it's wrong. But they did it anyway. They passed it. But we didn't stop there any more than we should stop now because Donald Trump got elected. So the next morning, we went to the House floor with an amendment in Paul Ryan's much-vaunted, promised open amendment process and made an amendment called the Maloney Amendment to take out the Russell Amendment, basically negate what it said. So nothing in the bill can affect the president's executive orders. And we put it up for a vote, and 36 Republicans joined all of the Democrats, and we passed that amendment to take out that anti-gay provision. Pretty good, right? Pretty good, right? But that's not the end of the story. Because while we were clapping, I was clapping, feel pretty good about myself, on the House floor, I looked over and Kevin McCarthy went to work. He's the Republican majority leader, some of you may know. And I noticed that the clock hadn't expired. It was a 2-minute vote. They kept it open for 8 minutes. And in the extra 6 minutes, Kevin McCarthy literally twisting arms and threatening members and making all kinds of promises or who knows what, flipped 7 Republicans who had just voted for my amendment, and they changed their votes to no. And so we had won, and then we lost. And the Democrats went bananas, to our credit. They started shouting shame, shame, shame at what they had pulled on the House floor. Google it. You can see it for yourself. So what do we do? We came back the next day, and we made the amendment again. Because those seven people who switched found out in a hurry that their hometown newspapers and their hometown moderates and persuadable voters thought discrimination against gay people wasn't such a hot idea, and they started getting nervous, and they all wanted to get right. So this time we brought back the Maloney Amendment, and it didn't get 36 votes down to 29. We got 43 Republicans who voted for it the second time. And this time, they knew they couldn't switch the votes back, so they brought down the whole appropriations bill it was attached to. The whole energy and water bill, they brought it down rather than pass it because my amendment was in it. So we lost again. And then they shut down the entire amendments process in the appropriations process in the United States Congress for the year because they knew they couldn't win if they let me make this amendment. We broke the appropriations process, right? And you know what it means? It means you can be in the majority. You can have more than 218 votes. But in 2016, you cannot bring an anti-gay measure onto the House floor and pass it. Your own guys won't do it. Their kids won't let them. Their newspapers won't let them. They feel bad about it. In fact, more of them want to vote with us than against us. We are winning these fights. We are winning these fights. And Donald Trump had better catch up to that. I'm not afraid of Donald Trump. I don't want you to be afraid of Donald Trump. We don't have to be afraid. We have to be organized. This process is working for us. It's working for LGBT Americans as much as it is for any other community that's been shut out. And we are a model for how to get things done in the American political system. But it isn't working because it just works. It's working because we work. It's working because all of you work. It's working because we run for office, because we raise money, because we sit at the card table, because we sign people up. We give to organizations like this one. We put dynamic, young, diverse leaders like Aisha Moodie-Mills in charge of this great organization, and she's awesome. And we need to be doing more of that. And the fact of the matter is, if we do our part, if we work, if we believe in ourselves, if we remember that a majority of Americans voted against this guy, not for him, that the people are actually with us, not him, that even in the Republican-dominated House, our stuff is a no-go zone for them because they're going to lose, then we can build off of our progress. And it won't be in a straight line because life doesn't work that way. Because we will always be taking a couple steps back, so we got to take a couple more steps forward. But if we keep working, if we keep pushing uphill against the wind, rocks in our backpack, I don't care. I'm not going home and telling my kids that because some reality TV star got elected president, our family's going to be less equal than everybody else's. I'm not going back to that world. I don't want you to go back to that world. And we need to build alliances. We need to build alliances with people of color and with new arrivals, with immigrants, with people who've been targeted by this guy. And together, collectively, we can be stronger and we can go forward. I believe it with all my heart. So I'm done mourning the election. I'm ready for the new morning that's going to dawn in America on January 3rd in the Congress and on January 20th in the presidency. And I'm going to sit on that platform as a member of the House of Representatives, and I'm going to be polite, and I'm going to be respectful of the duly elected President of the United States. And then I'm going to go to work to stop every stupid thing he wants to do to take America back. Because I have a seat at the table, and I want more of you to have a seat at the table. I want Tammy Baldwin to have more power in the Senate. I want help. I want more members of Congress who are LGBT. I want more members of the Senate, right? We need a few more. I want a couple of gay Republicans elected. That ought to change things over in their caucus, don't you think? Because let me tell you what, and I'll shut up. Let me tell you what, the number one thing that happened during the Maloney Amendment, the number one thing that happened to me, is that members of the other party came up to me and they said, you know, I can't be with you on this, but you know where I am on your issues. And I just had it. I don't know about you, but you get to that point, right, where you're tired of trying to make somebody else feel better, right? I said, hey, man, it's not my job to make you feel better. Why don't you go get a dog? Why don't you, like, go get it? Why don't you go, you know, that's not my job. Don't tell me you're good on my issues when there's a red N up there on my amendment. Your vote is where you are on my issues. Stand up or sit down, but do not tell me you're good when you're not. Because I am not here to make you feel better. My point to you is that if we are at the table, if we are in the room, we have crossed that threshold where they cannot justify their opposition to us. Not in a national legislature. Sure, in some states. Sure, in local communities. Sure, in individual families. There's so much struggle and so much suffering. I know that. I'm not blind to that. But I will tell you, they cannot get away with it anymore in the United States Congress or in your national government unless we let them. Let's not let them. Let's get to work. Let's win. God bless all of you. I'll see you later. Thank you.
Now, please give a warm welcome to the first openly LGBT United States Senator, Senator Tammy Baldwin of Wisconsin, for a conversation with Aisha Moodie-Mills.
All right. Greetings.
All right.
All right.
So those of you who knew me in my former, still sometimes now, life of Politini, my favorite thing ever to do in life is to interview folks. So I'm so excited to be here with you, Senator.
I'm excited too.
So we have just heard from Mayor Gonzales and from the Congressman and from Dr. Levine. You know, representation obviously matters. That's what we're all here talking about. And so I would just love to hear from you and all of your experience, you know, your take on why representation matters, and perhaps one of your favorite examples of where you've seen us just exude power in a meaningful way because we were there.
Well, I think, you know, the quote that we heard earlier, if you're not at the table, you're on the menu. And another way of looking at the same thing is that if you're not in the room, the conversation is about you, at best. At worst, you don't even come up, right? If you're in the room, the conversation is with you. And I have seen so many conversations transformed because we're a part of it. People talking about you versus people talking with you is a huge, huge difference. And I can think of instances where early in my time in politics, I discovered the difference of women's voices being heard in conversations. And I certainly know the difference it's made when LGBT voices are heard. I also think about how much all of you inspire others as leaders. Being in that room, at that table, in that position of power, and you know, typically I think about this with young people who get a chance to see someone who's a little like them succeed and think, I can do this too. And know that they can do this too. But it's not always the young people. I will never forget meeting Del Martin and Phyllis Lyons. Now, yeah. I was so excited to meet them. I was at a lesbian power conference, and I had just been elected to the House of Representatives, so this is 1999. And so I'm like, I see Del, and I come up, and she says, Tammy, Tammy, Phyllis, get over here. And she bursts into tears, and she said, this is what I have worked my entire life for. This is what we've worked our entire life for. I was so thrilled to meet them as role models. They were so thrilled to see the fruits of their labor for so many decades. As, you know, I was a symbol of that. You are all symbols of that and inspiration for so many others. And so it's the symbolic and it's the substantive part of the conversation.
Mm-hmm. Talk to us about the personal side of politics. And for you, I mean, we can talk all day long about the failed strategies and maneuvers that, you know, got us to whatever election result. And sometimes we forget about the actual people that are involved in elections. And so I would love for you to give us just a little glimpse into the personal side of the politics that made you want to be a part of it and run for office.
Well, yeah, it is. I do know a few politicians here and there who run simply because they seem to want power or just seem to think that they should be elected in some position. But most of, every person in the LGBT community that I've ever met who has sought office or appointed positions has been motivated by their life experiences or the experiences of loved ones. I find that true a lot about a lot of the women that I serve with at various levels, but certainly in the United States Senate, that there was like a cause, a fire in the belly. So for me, it was a number of things. So I first ran for the Dane County Board of Supervisors in 1986. I was elected that spring. I was 24 years old. And there were two issues that I felt passionate about beyond the many issues that I feel passionate about. One was based on my life experience growing up. I was raised by my maternal grandparents, and I had a significant, serious childhood illness. At age 9, not unlike spinal meningitis, it wasn't exactly that. And my grandparents, after I was in the hospital for 3 months, realized that their family insurance didn't cover their granddaughter. And they sacrificed already to raise me, but you know, it was a big deal, and they didn't burden me with it when I was 9. They wouldn't. They wanted me to get better, and they were supportive of me. But I learned later how much they sacrificed. And I felt that no parent or grandparent or foster parent or anyone should ever have to go through that. And healthcare for all became something I felt really, really passionately about. And it, at age 24, as a law student, I kept reading about university students at the University of Wisconsin-Madison who became ill, didn't have insurance, and were either not getting the care they needed or falling through the cracks. So that was one issue. And the other was I had just come out. I came out in college. And I was doing everything I could to learn about this new family that I was a part of, if you will. There weren't that many books at the time. There were a few documentaries. I think I saw them all multiple times. And but I was learning about the movement and these leaders. Like, that's when I first learned about Del Martin and Phyllis Lyons and Harvey Milk, and you know. And so it was 1986. And as I was running for the Dane County Board of Supervisors, Dane County also had news of the first individuals in our community with HIV/AIDS. And all of a sudden, the two issues that I felt most passionately about converged. And I had this remarkable opportunity to run, win, and lead in a way that I think made a tremendous difference in my county and my state. And yeah, it was deeply personal, but also, as you all know, incredibly, incredibly rewarding.
Wow. 24 years old, huh? That's how old you were when you first ran?
So this is my 30th year in elective office. Wow.
Nice.
It's a little anniversary.
That's awesome. So you heard earlier that we have a lot of young people here. We have Coca-Cola's Next Generation Fellows that are with us. And then we also have our Victory interns and our Victory Fellow and lots of young people here. 24 years old, you had some real clarity. What would you say to millennials today who are completely disgusted with the deadlock and the rhetoric and the this and the that, and they don't necessarily feel that public service is the best way to make change? What would you say to them to inspire them as a 24-year-old to get involved and to run?
Well, first of all, I, like probably everyone here, want to say that I get how difficult it has been to hear the rhetoric, to hear what's been said, what's been tweeted, what's been out there. And I understand why that would be potentially a turnoff for getting involved in public life. Do not listen to those voices. Do not listen to the cynics and the naysayers and the keepers of the status quo, because if you don't, this will persist. I also think that we really, really need to broaden our definition of what it means to be political and to be involved politically. A lot of what we need to do right now at this time is strengthen our commitments to people who are working at the grassroots in nonprofit organizations and advocacy organizations. You know, I don't know if all of you had the same sort of variety of conversations that I did immediately following the election. I was on the phone a lot, and it was everything from people who were, you know, curled up in a little ball on their couch and saying they were never going to move again. And there's still a few people in that state. But to people who said, I made 5 donations today, you know, Planned Parenthood, Southern Poverty Law Center, ACLU, Victory Fund, right? On and on. And that's what I feel like my first action has to be at this very difficult moment in our nation's history, and in my case, in my state's evolution, devolution, whatever we want to call it. And it's not just writing out checks, because I know for me at 24, there wasn't that much to write out. But to be involved at the grassroots level, and I think it's also incredibly important for us to hear all of those right now who are fearful, because we know it is certainly not limited to people in the LGBTQ community, that the voices of those who are frightened right now need to be heard. We need to stand and sit in solidarity. And so that we have to broadly define political action. And I think those of you starting out, I mean, that's kind of how I started out before even actually running for office, was to be so involved in my community and to find where I could make a powerful difference, maybe just by volunteering a couple of hours, et cetera. And then, you know, the next steps were connecting the dots and seeing that I could elevate that by running for local office. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you mentioned your state of Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. Tell us, give us your take on how just 4 years ago the state of Wisconsin could elect its first, elect our first lesbian to the U.S. Senate. And then, yes. Which, by the way, guys, you know, the Senate terms are 6 years, so that means that in 2018, Wisconsin will re-elect our first mm-hmm. lesbian senator, of course, with our help.
That's right.
So tell me how we go from you to then a Scott Walker and a Donald Trump winning in the state
yeah.
of Wisconsin.
So it went Scott Walker.
Governor Scott Walker.
During the Tea Party 2010 revolution. And then in 2012, I got to be on the same ticket as Barack Obama, running for his reelection. You know, we've had activity since then. But this was a very, very difficult election in Wisconsin. And as you can imagine, as somebody gearing up to run for reelection in 2018, we're taking a hard look at what happened. And I don't want to get into a sort of post-election analysis lecture here, but I can tell you the top things that we know. We expected a victory in Wisconsin for Hillary Clinton and for Russ Feingold, who was running for Senate. We were feeling confident probably until the polls closed. We're feeling confident because our early vote rocked it. I mean, it was history-making how many people came out and voted early, and we felt good about that. On election day, there was an enormous drop-off in our state. We performed 4% below what was projected. Only 4 out of our 72 counties outperformed the expectations. And so that was a huge factor, and we're going to study further to learn whether that was our new voter restriction laws like the photo ID laws we have, or whether it was issues of expectation that because Hillary and Russ were so far ahead, people didn't come out and vote, or what sort of series of issues caused that to happen. But secondly, we don't have a lot of swing voters in Wisconsin. I don't know about all of your states. We used to. We used to have a lot of very independent voters and ticket splitters, but we don't anymore. Sort of post-Scott Walker, it's very polarized. But we do have a small percentage of swing voters who this election cycle decided very late and decided for Trump. And these swing voters had decided to cast a vote for Tammy Baldwin 4 years ago. And my sense, my very strong sense, and we will research this like you won't believe, was really about economics and about whether they were being seen and heard as they struggled. And as I said, we'll study that a lot, but I think that that will be a key in my re-election, is to continually focus on the dignity of work. And how does that involve our community? Well, how many years have we been struggling for
ENDA? Yeah.
And the Equality
Act. Are we at 20 yet? Yeah,
how much? I remember, you know, I got the pleasure of serving with Barney Frank when I was in the House, right? And he's like, I was asked about the radical gay agenda. And he said, we want to serve in the military, we want to get married, and we want to work. how radical is that, right?
So, here we are now. You are in leadership in the United States.
Yes.
Fact. Very exciting.
Yep.
And you have a big job ahead because coming to your desk are going to be this long list of bad actors that Donald Trump is putting forth to work for him. And so, you know, the buck stops with the Senate. So I would love for you to share with us all as we are going out into our communities and figuring out, you know, what are we gonna do? Do you have any thoughts yet about how you're planning to engage with the administration and any advice for us?
Yeah, you know, I start by thinking about this in several different categories of activities. Let's start with protecting our progress. I mean, we just had 8 years of the most pro-LGBTQ presidency that we've ever had, right? And we've passed important laws. There's been some incredible progress with regards to rulemaking. And there are executive orders in place that protect us. Congressman Maloney talked about the president's executive order to require all government contractors to have in place employment protections on the basis of sexual orientation and gender identity. That is one that we're going to have to fight very hard to keep in place, to protect our progress. And that'll be one of the first things that I look at as this new administration takes place, and what are the actions contemplated on that. Secondly, I'd go back to an issue we're talking about in terms of people's reaction and how many people are so deeply fearful right now. And the upsurge in hate crimes and hate speech and bullying and harassment has been terrifying and well reported. So one of the things that many of you may have seen when Trump did his quick interview with, or his long interview with 60 Minutes, and he was told about this upsurge in harassment and bullying and hate attacks, and he said, stop it. Well, those right now are just words. But I think a very strong focus on bolstering the ability of our Department of Justice to prevent, investigate, and enforce our hate crimes laws is going to be a key part of our early agenda. I think we have to continue to move forward with the Equality Act. I mean, I've been in the minority in legislative bodies before. I've spent more time in the minority, frankly, than the majority. But partly how you organize and move things forward is continue to advance that agenda of progress and try to count more and more supporters and add them to the effort. And then I think that coordination with all of you fighting the battles at the local and state level is also going to be exceedingly key. And then finally, the stuff that we hate doing, but is playing defense. There are going to be measures that are harmful, that are introduced in states, in localities, and in the United States Congress. And we are going to have to learn lessons from each other's struggles on those things, but fight mightily to make sure we don't lose ground.
Mm-hmm. Well, as a last word, we are so thankful to have you doing the good work that you're doing on behalf of all of us in the Senate. And so tell us, as we close, what can we all be doing to better support you as you fight the good fight on our behalf?
Oh, That's, be out. Be out, be out. You know, I think about this all the time, that sometimes the earliest lessons we learned as a movement about how we make progress ring as true today as they did, you know, whether it was Harvey Milk exhorting us to come out wherever we are. I think our visibility, our stories, our voices are our most powerful tool in terms of making progress. If I think about where things were in 1986 when I was first elected to office, we were largely invisible and we had a minority of support among the American people. And today, as we've been more vocal and visible, not just as individuals, but as families, more people know us, and a majority of Americans now feel that their LGBTQ brothers, sisters, family members, friends, co-workers should be treated just like everyone else. And so always a central core of who we are and how we organize and how we make progress has to be speaking out, being visible, and being proud. That's the easiest and most fundamental thing that all of you can do moving forward. But I'll be asking you for help. Don't worry. I have a lot of work to do,
well, you
and I need
here.
All of you.
Be visible. Be fabulous. Thank you so much. Join me in giving a round of applause to Senator Baldwin.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're so glad to have you.
Oh, this is a joy.
Thank you
for coming.
The next round of sessions will begin at 2:10 p.m.